So woody invasive plants as a whole generally are aggressive sprouters, which means if you cut them down, damage them down close to the ground, they're going to come back and sprout. And that's going to limit what we can do in terms of mechanical control. But there are some advantages. Most of our woody invasive plants have relatively short-lived seed banks. So their seeds, when they fall, only live a year or two in the soil. And because of that, you know, we want to target to kill the plants. You don't necessarily worry too much about the seeds because they're only going to live a short time there. And then some of them are clonal growers, which they can spread out by roots on the ground. But in general, kind of the theme is killing the root system, finding the way to get that root system out of the ground so that it will not sprout back. There's a lot of different options for controlling invasive plants, chemical options, others. What I wanted to focus on right now was mechanical options or non-chemical options. Obviously, that's an option for you. It's going to depend a bit on the size of the plants that you're dealing with and how many you have. Large infestations or big plants, it's going to be harder to use some of these mechanical options. Small infestations, small plants, it can work really well. One thing that we see a lot with woody invasive plant control are kind of mechanical aids like these weed wrenches or puller bears. There's a bunch of different options out there. Obviously the automala behind me is way too big for this, but this does give you a little bit of an advantage in terms of leverage to get bigger things out than you can just by your hands. Small bush honeysuckles, some other plants, they're fairly shallow rooted and you can pull them out of the ground fairly easily, up to a certain size, maybe size of your thumb. Using one of these tools can get you the opportunity to get ones that are even bigger. So these work pretty straightforward. They have basically a clamp at the bottom and then some flat places to kind of give you a little bit of ability not to sink into the mud. You clamp this at the base of the plant and then use the lever to leverage it out of the ground. We're going to go find some honeysuckle and give it a shot with that. Deep-rooted plants like autumn olive, even the small ones can be difficult. So you kind of have to figure out how they work with the plants that you're dealing with and the sizes that are most appropriate. So here's a decent sized honeysuckle, a little bigger than your thumb, but you can see this would be kind of hard to pull out just by your hands. And that's again the advantage of some of these mechanical aids. So with these, you basically, as I mentioned, you get around the base, hook onto the plant, and then lever it out. When you do control these and pull them out of the ground, it's generally a good idea not to just lay them on the ground. I kind of lean them up against a tree or hang them upside down, something so the roots don't touch the ground, just in case they try to re-root.
I'm going to be demonstrating how to do foliar control of bush honeysuckle. So you never want to spray any plants that are over 5 to 6 feet. You just don't want to spray up in the air because that puts obviously you in danger, and also there's a risk of pesticide drift. So this plant's still pretty green, which is good. You want it to be green so it can uptake that chemical. You know, later in the fall towards winter, these are going to start to yellow and it will not be as effective. So what you want to do is you want to get your backpack sprayer on and you want to make sure you've got your nozzle to the right setting so that, you know, you can get good full coverage. You don't want a concentrated jet stream of the chemical. You want a good mist so that you can get full coverage of the foliage. So what you're going to do is hold it high over the foliage of the bush honeysuckle, apply the chemical. When you're doing this, you want to, it's almost like you're painting, so you want to get good coverage over everything. And that is how you effectively do a foliar spray control of woody invasives. Today we're going to talk about cut stump. And cut stump is a very useful tool on woody invasives like autumn olives, especially when they're above 5 or 6 feet. So let's go ahead and get started. Alright guys, so we've successfully removed the main stem of the autumn olive, and we've exposed this stump here. So what we've found is that you want to treat your stump with a systemic herbicide within 15 minutes of cutting down the autumn olive. And so what you want to do is, obviously, you want to have the proper PPE. You want to have your nitrile gloves and your goggles. What you want to do is you want to take your chemical and you want to spray just the cambium of the outer stump. So this living area of the stump. So what you guys will notice is that I didn't put any chemical in the center. There's no reason to. Anything less than 6 inches in diameter, you're gonna treat the whole stump. But in this case, you don't need to.
So Zach did a great job showing a cut stump treatment on a big autumn olive. The same method can be used and scaled for really any size of woody plant that you're dealing with. One of the advantages of some of the smaller stuff, like these smaller bush honeysuckle, is that you don't have to use power tools. So while he used a chainsaw for that one and it was the appropriate tool, these smaller ones can afford you to do non-power tools that may be more appropriate for using volunteers that don't require as much training. Things like these loppers. And so using a cut stump is a great tool to use when you're doing volunteer days and you have a lot of people out there and you don't want to get into power tools. The principle is the same. You're basically cutting it low down, treating the stump. As Zach said, when they're this small, you just treat the whole stump. I like to be a little liberal with my herbicide when I'm doing a cut stump, just to make sure that it gets controlled. But again, these small ones, you're just treating the whole thing. We're going to talk about basal bark treatment as an option for woody shrubs now. Basal bark has some advantages. The biggest one is it doesn't require multiple types of equipment, so you're not cutting it down or doing a hack and squirt or doing something else and then treating. All you're doing is treating with herbicide. That's the advantage. The disadvantage is it tends to use more herbicide than some of these other methods, and the reason why is you're applying a more concentrated version of the herbicide directly onto the bark, and it gets basically taken up through the bark and then translocated down into the roots to kill the plant. Some things about it, really the only types of herbicide that work for this would be the kind of ester-based herbicides that you put in oil. Those are the ones that are going to be able to penetrate through the bark. So your traditional water-based glyphosates and things like that don't really apply in this method. There's several different herbicides that work well for basal bark. We can talk about that at some point too, but it's the ones that basically are systemic herbicides, that are esters, that are oil-based herbicides that work well. When you do a basal bark, it's important to treat starting at the ground level up to 12, 14 inches tall, all sides of the bark. If it's a multi-stem shrub like this autumn olive here, you'd want to get every stem. This works well for thin barked plants. Plants that have thicker bark, corky bark, it doesn't really work well for. So bush honeysuckle, we don't really use it that much. But autumn olive, which is a thin bark species, tree of heaven, which is a thin bark species, even younger common buckthorn, thin bark species, it works pretty well. I typically reserve this method for plants that are, say, 6 inches in diameter or less. One, because those bigger plants that are over 6 inches in diameter tend to get more corky bark and you get less uptake in herbicide. But also, simply because you have to treat the whole entire circumference of that bark, those bigger plants just take a lot more herbicide. And so I like this for smaller plants, for sure. You're not having to deal with slash because you're not cutting these plants down. They're up and standing. You leave them standing. Works good any time of year, except for spring. You want to caution in the winter when there's snow cover on, that can actually reduce some uptake, as well as if you're in a bottomland situation that floods often and you get a lot of silt or dirt on the bark itself, that can actually reduce uptake. So those are the kind of precautions, but in general, this works very, very well for thin bark species. This autumn olive, we're going to go ahead and kind of do it and just show you what it looks like. I really like backpack sprayers for this because it has enough herbicide in there. The little pump sprayers or hand sprayers can sometimes be a pain. I also like a long wand. That way it keeps you from bending over all day and it just kind of helps you in fatigue. But when you do this, you want to use more of a stream instead of a wide fan. And you don't want to use a lot of pressure because you're not have to spray it far. You're just kind of putting it right on the bark. Again, ground level up to 12, 14 inches. And then you just treat it, get a decent coverage. And then you want to make sure you hit every stem on all sides. And that's it. You can see that it uses a little more herbicide, but again, very, very quick, very easy, and doesn't require a lot of specialized equipment. We're going to talk about collectively, these treatments for woody plants are called injection treatments. Separately, we tend to call them other names. They go by hack and squirt. There's one called drill and fill. There's a bunch of different names for them. But injection's kind of the generic term. Basically, what we're looking at is putting concentrated herbicide and making it in contact with the cambial layer kind of under the bark. This involves damaging the bark or somehow getting inside of it, either with a drill or a hatchet, and then putting that herbicide again right in there. The advantage to this is there's very little chance for non-target impact since it's such a directed application. You don't have to deal with the slash like you do with the cut stump, so you're not actually cutting anything down. It's staying kind of on the stump. And then one of the things that you have to watch for is this is a bit of a slow method to kill them. So a lot of times, if you're doing this in the winter, those plants will actually sometimes leaf out in the spring. And it may worry you because, they're coming, but then oftentimes they'll leaf out and then kind of wilt away and die after that. If you're using the right herbicide, it can be very, very effective. What we're going to do is look at both methods, the hack and squirt and the drill and fill here. We have a maple, and I know this isn't a woody invasive plant, but it is something that we often control or manage in oak hickory systems, so we thought it was a good one to do. This is a very effective method on any woody plant. It's probably best and most practical used on some of our woody trees or our bigger shrubs that are large enough that you can get in there. Some of the smaller multi-stem stuff or things that branch low to the ground, it's just too difficult to get in there to control these. But for trees, taller things, it's a very effective method. Let's start with hack and squirt. So hack and squirt, again, you are basically putting a chop into the tree. When you do that, you want to use a sharp implement. I like these Swedish brush axes here. You can use hatchets, machetes, anything like that. You want to do that at a downward angle. So that basically creates that cut is facing upward, and that's just going to hold the herbicide in. It depends on the herbicide you use on how many of these you need to do per tree. If you look at the label, it's going to say basically how many milliliters of herbicide you need to put per tree. It varies by herbicide, so make sure to read your label. But here's basically just a quick example. So we're gonna do it right here, again, at that downward angle. You're gonna come in, do that, and then sometimes you can actually leave the blade in there and then do a squirt right into that. So you can see here, it's kind of holding the majority of that herbicide. This size tree, that's probably all you need. For a bigger tree, you would then go on the opposite side and do another chop with that. A more of a newer method for this injection, you know, instead of hack and squirt, is what we call it drill and fill. And so it's the same basic principle. You're damaging that, you're exposing that cambial layer and putting concentrated herbicide, except we're using a cordless drill. I like this method. I've been using it for a couple years now, and it seems to be very fast, very effective, and it really does a good job of holding that herbicide into that tree or that woody plant until it dies or it's taken up. So I do like this method. When it's the same thing, what you're doing a hack and squirt, is that you want to go in at a downward angle, so it's going to have the ability to hold that herbicide into that hole longer than if it was flat or angled down. So you come in at a downward angle, you want to go fast and go in about an inch to an inch and a half. So just like that, and then you put the herbicide right down into that hole, roughly just one squirt to that hole, puts it in there. Very, very effective, very quick, very easy, with almost no opportunity for non-target impacts. A couple notes about injection methods that you need to take into account, and they're really the same ones we talk about with cut stump and basal bark, and that's your timing. So any of these plants that are woody plants that you're controlling with these methods, really fall is usually your most effective time. And that's because it's taking the energy down into the roots, it's getting ready to shut down for winter. And you're kind of hijacking that system to take the herbicide down into the roots. You remember what we talked about earlier, these are woody plants that sprout aggressively. Your goal is to control the root system, not necessarily the above ground part. You need to kill that plant and kill the root system. So hijacking that by doing it in the fall, you usually have very good control. These can also be effective in the winter, as long as it's not really late winter. And even in the summer, what you want to really avoid is the springtime. And then even with some plants, and maple's a great example, that late winter, early spring, that sap's coming and it'll literally push the herbicide right out of that hole or that surface that you cut. So again, stay away from late winter through spring, but summer, fall, early winter, great times to do this method.